Good morning, students. So let us have a review of whatever has been done in the last class, and we can start with today's content as well. So in the previous class, we had discussed about the contents of this particular module. We had also discussed the prerequisites required for this module and the expected outcomes after learning the module. And we had discussed that 8051 finds applications in various fields including domestic, agriculture, automotive, health, and you name the industry, we can find the microcontrollers, right? The microcontroller that might have been used may be different. We may have microcontrollers with different names, but you find its place in any of the field you can think of, right? And coming to embedded systems, when we discuss about embedded system, 8051 is the heart of the system, and it has to be associated with lot many devices as well, right? Now, so whenever we are interfacing the additional devices to 8051, there is a requirement for the microcontroller to have communication with the interfacing devices. So when you're speaking of the communication that has to be done, the communication could be either from the devices that have been connected, or it could be from the microcontroller, which is working as a heart of the system, right? Depending upon the mode of communication, depending upon whether the devices are communicating to 8051 or 8051 is communicating to the devices, that is, depending on who is taking the initiative, we do have two different schemes. One is polling, other one is interrupt mechanism. These are the two different mechanisms rather, right? In polling mechanism, what happens is that 8051 will be seeking each and every device whether the device is in need of microcontroller's help. In case of interrupt, what happens is the devices which are in need of interrupt will be requesting the microcontroller to help in for the particular requirement, right? So this is what was discussed in the previous class. In addition to that, we had also discussed the comparison between the interrupt and polling mechanisms, and we have also discussed what happens when an interrupt arises from the interfacing devices to 8051. The present topic is pertaining to interrupt students, so we need to have more learning, more understanding about interrupt mechanism, right? So as such is the requirement, we need to understand what happens when an interrupt is arise from the interfacing device. So the interfacing devices arises the interrupts, and the sequence of operations that take place is the 8051 will stop whatever it has been doing presently, and it will go and execute the program that has been written in the interrupt service routine. And once he completes the program, at the end he will have an instruction called return on interrupt, right? So once the return on interrupt instruction is executed, he will come back to the main program and he will resume his job, right? This is what was discussed. And coming to 8051, there are six different interrupts. Reset is of highest priority. Okay, as soon as the reset switch is pressed, your 8051 will start working from the address 0000h, irrespective of whatever is the operation that has been performing by 8051, irrespective of how critical the operation is, okay, irrespective of the priority with which he has been working with. Okay, once you press the reset button, 8051 will stop everything and he will go back to the address 0000h, right? So, and coming to the interrupts, so along with the reset, there are five different interrupts. Two are from timer and two are from external hardware, right? And we have discussed how these timer interrupts and hardware interrupts work by considering two different real-time requirements, right? Now, so moving on, we had discussed about the interrupt enabled register. Okay, it may be a situation that the devices may be seeking the help of the microcontroller, but it is not necessary that the 8051 will respond to the device. If the 8051 responds to the device or no depends upon the bit that has been set in the interrupt enable register. You understand? If the bit is not set in the interrupt enable register, if the bit pertaining to that particular interfacing device is not set in the interrupt enable register, how many hour times the device has generated the request, 8051 is not going to look into that. Clear? So the external hardware that have been connected, okay, should give the signal which the 8051 will be able to understand, rather acknowledge. At the same time, we need to set the appropriate bits in the IE register as well. Clear? So this is what was discussed. Okay, so we have bits like EX0, ET0, EX1, ET1. EX0 and EX01 are for external hardware interrupts. ET0 and ET1 are for timer interrupts. In addition to that, we have an interrupt for serial communication. Only if these bits are set, the hardware interrupt could be recognized by 8051, not otherwise. Dear students, please do understand the hardware and software are going hand in hand. Okay, so we might have connected the hardware external devices, but if you do not tell 8051 these are the devices that are being connected, 8051, and these are the devices which need to be acknowledged whenever the interrupt is arise from the devices, only then the 8051 is going to acknowledge the devices and it is going to take proper action. That could be done only by setting the appropriate bits in the IC register. At the same time, if you do not want the 8051 to respond to a particular device, you can make the bit low. That is, you are going to disable the bit by making the bit low. When you do so, even if the external devices generate the interrupts, the 8051 is not going to consider them. Clear? In addition to that, okay, we have a special bit, that is the EA bit. If at all you want the 8051 to respond to any of these bits, the EA bit has to be made high. That's why I said in the last class, the very first jump that the programmer does during initiation part of the programming is setting EA bit. Set bit EA, set BEA, okay, will enable all the interrupts. If this particular bit is low, okay, then even if your hardware has raised the request and even if you have set the bit in this IE register, the 8051 is not going to consider that. That is the importance of EA bit, students. Okay, so my suggestion to you is, you may be using the devices individually. What I suggest is you set the bit EA, set bit EA at the beginning of the program, that is during the initial part. Okay, then in the later part of the programming, depending upon your requirement, you should be able to set and reset, rather enable and disable the interrupts according to your requirement. In some part of the program, you may not be wanting the timer to be enabled, rather timer to interrupt the 8051 functioning even if the timer raises the request. So you know how the requirement comes, you know how the application works. Depending upon your requirement, you set the reset the bit. Clear? Okay, this is what was discussed in the previous class. Now moving on. So let us see how it works within 8051. How this is a logical diagram, okay, to illustrate how does the 8051 function depending upon the interrupts raised by various devices. So whenever these, see here, we have INT0, right? This is INT0 is for what? Interrupt 0, right? This is it hardware or software? INT0 is, you remember students, pin number 12 of 8051. Port 3.2 is INT0, right? So here we have made it active high, means what? So actually in the pin 8051, it is active low, right? So only when the bit is low, you are going to get the INT0. So I have made it the reverse, I have not put bar here, I have made it INT0 and I am showing it as active high in this case, right? Now if INT0 bits gets activated and if EX0 of the IE register bit is set, only then this AND gate is going to give a high signal here. You understand? This is what I was telling just before. Okay, if this INT0 is set, if EX0 is not set, it is not going to generate a logical signal. Similarly, for the other logic also. If INT1 is raised by the hardware, only if it is enabled in the software, then you will get the higher the output of the AND gate, not otherwise. Okay, similarly, so TF0 is the flag raised by the timer whenever the overflow happens. Okay, if ET0 bit of the IE register is not set, even though TF0 flag is raised, the output you are going to get is going to be 0. Clear? Okay, and similarly for TF timer 1, that is, you have to set ET1 high if at all you want the 8051 to recognize it. Clear? So, in addition to these interrupts, I said reset is the highest priority interrupt. So, in addition to these interrupts, we have an interrupt from serial communication. I said when we speak about communication, it is both transmission as well as reception. Okay, whenever we are doing transmission TI flag will be set, transmission interrupt flag will be set. Okay, at the same time, whenever we are doing reception, receive interrupt flag will be set. If any one of these two is set, the output of the R flag is going to be 1, right? Now, so if any one of these set the interrupt and the serial, if a serial communication flag is set, only then you are going to get the AND gate output as high. Okay, now if any one of these devices, it could be your timer 0, timer 1, or it could be external hardware. Okay, it could be in a class we had discussed about light sensor and temperature sensor, right? One is for switching on and switching off the light, other one is for switching on the refrigerator when you are not in station, right? That was the applications which we had discussed earlier, right? Now, so these devices might have generated the logic high output, right? So if any one of these devices generate the logic high output, the output of this gate is going to be, right? Now, the output of this may be high, but when will it interrupt CPU? Only when its EA is high. That's what I said. You set the bit EA at the very beginning of the program so that this EA is not going to stop the 8051 or make the 8051 or help the 8051 to recognize the interrupts whenever they are generated. Clear? So EA should be made high so that the R gate, whenever the R gate output becomes high, when will the R gate output becomes high? Whenever the AND gate output becomes high. When will the AND gate output becomes high? Whenever the two interrupt, whenever the two inputs of the AND gates. Okay. So when does the AND gate output becomes high? Whenever the inputs are high. When the input becomes high, when EA is enabled and the output of R gate is high. When does the output of the R gate is high? When any one of the inputs of the R gate is high. When any one of the inputs of the R gate will become high? When both the inputs for the AND gate is high. Okay, so when this happens, the 8051 will be interrupted. When the 8051 is interrupted, what will he do? He will stop doing whatever he has been currently doing. That was the normal functioning. Then he will go to the interrupt service routine. Right? He will go and execute the program that has been written in the interrupt service routine. Once he does that, he will come back to the main program. He will resume execution. Clear, students? This is how the overall interrupt mechanism takes place in the 8051. Right? Okay. Now, let us move on to the next. Now, I said reset is of highest priority. Yes or no? So, let whatever the functioning that has been done by 8051, once you press the reset button, what will he do? He will stop executing whatever he has been doing currently and he will go and to the address 0000H, right? But what about the other interrupts? is there any priority for these interrupts? Right? There will not be any problem if the interrupts are arise by the devices one after the other. Right? The one which comes first will be served first, naturally. Okay, that is what is expected to happen, right? But on the other hand, if all these devices rise interrupt simultaneously, then whom should be given the priority? Who should be served first? This is the question. Okay, microcontroller manufacturers are very much aware that VPO have such problems. So what have they done is, they have said, okay, Intel has said, now the other manufacturers also have told, by default, okay, when you press the reset button or when the 8051 starts working from the beginning, from the address 0000H, this is a priority that he will follow. So by default, what is the priority that will be followed by 8051? He will consider interrupt 0 first and timer interrupt 0 as the second priority, interrupt 1 as the next priority, and timer 1 as the fourth priority, and serial communication has been given the last priority. Right? This is the default priority set by the manufacturer, whosoever has been manufacturing 8051, whether it is Intel, Philips, Fairchild, Motorola, okay, AMD, it does not matter who the manufacturer is. They all will follow this particular protocol. Right? By default, this is what will be done. Now, this is what has been decided by the 8051 manufacturer students. But here I have a requirement. What is the requirement I have? I have a timer. Okay, you know that lot of webinars are going on in different places across the nation and across the world. Right? Everyone wants to use this lockdown period or the period which is this particular period for better learning, right? So now we want to allocate time for each of these webinars. Let us assume we have a calendar where we are having an 8051 based calendar where we are going to schedule the time for each of the webinars that you want to learn. Okay, so in that calendar you are going to say from 6 to 7 I have to learn, attend webinar organized by IEEE, 7:30 to 8:30, the NPTEL lecture series, 9 to 10, timings may vary students, 9 to 10, something else. So you are scheduling your time to attend different webinars. So we want our 8051 to give us an alarm 5 minutes before the program starts, right? Okay, now we have set an RTC, we have set a timer, and we want that to tell us that the program is going to get over in the next 5 minutes, right? So we want to have one such application. So we have connected, we have used the timer 0 for that particular requirement. One timer is more than sufficient because we are having time at different slots, is it not? So we will be able to manage this by using a single timer. If you at all we had to have two different we had to attend two different events in parallel, then we had to use two different timers. That could not happen anyway. Okay, so one timer will be able to fulfill the requirement, and let us assume we have been using timer 0 for all these requirements. For all the three events we are going to use only timer 0. Okay, now this is one such, that is a calendar and having an alarm is one such requirement. And have one more requirement. In that requirement, I want to use the 8051 as a fire extinguisher as well. Okay, so whenever there is a smoke that has been sensed in any corner of the place where I'm staying, okay, I want the fire extinguisher, I want the controller to sense that. And I want the controller to switch on the fire extinguisher that is situated close by instantaneously. Okay, this is my another requirement. The third requirement I have is, whenever I have been attending these webinars, I do not want to get interrupted for any reason. Is it not? Right? So what I do, I will have a telephone answering system. Actually, my let us assume that I have a phone which do not have automatic voice recording and answering system. So I want to 8051 to receive the call whenever I am busy with these webinars. Okay, and it should be in a position to tell the people whosoever has been calling that so and so is busy with the webinars. You please call after say 8 or whatever is the free time that has been told. Can we have one such system? Yes. So we are trying to do these things by having our hero, that is 8051. Right. Now when we are attending, let us have a case study. See, now I am attending the webinar. Right. I have been attending the webinar. Now what has happened is, in some corner of the place the fire has been sensed. Okay. Now the fire sensor has sensed that smoke, and he has been trying to tell 8051 that the smoke is there in so and so place, in such and such a place. At the same time, I got a call from one of my friend, and he is also trying to tell 8051 that a call is being received. You understand? A call is being received. Now the question is, whom should the 8051 attend? You understand, students? Okay, I repeat, the fire sensor has sensed that there is a fire, and he is trying to tell 8051 there is a fire. Okay, he is trying to interrupt 8051. At the same instance of time, okay, what has happened? Somebody is trying to call us. Okay, so this telephone is also trying to tell 8051 that a call has been received. You please try to attend the call and play the message. You understand? Okay, now the question is, whom should the 8051 attend? The common sense says 8051 should attend the fire sensor. He should immediately switch on the fire extinguisher. Right? This is the one which should be given the highest priority. But what the 8051 will do is, he will go and attend the telephone. Why will he do so? Because we have given INT0 as the higher. It is not that we have given, the manufacturer has given INT0 as the highest priority. Now, as a design engineer, can I expect one such situation? Yes, it is possible. Okay, the sensors can send the signal simultaneously to the devices. But how are we going to respond to the interrupts that are being aroused by the devices is what makes the difference. Okay, the manufacturer has told this is the priority that will be followed by default. But the manufacturer has also given us an option to change the priority. You said the common sense says the fire extinguisher should be switched on immediately. Means what? The fire sensor should be given the higher priority, not the telephone answering machine. Now, if that is what has been told, then how are we going to give him the priority is the question. For that, we have a register called interrupt priority register. You name the problem, students, engineering field has a solution. Okay, we are there to provide solutions. We are solution providers always, right? So we have interrupt priority register, who will say, though this is the default, so though this is the default priority, it need not be the consideration all the time. So what can we do instead? We can change the priority according to our requirement. How are you going to change the priority, students? For that, we have interrupt priority register. In that interrupt priority register, we have 5 different bits. Reset is by default of highest priority, so we do not need to consider him at all. Okay, so here we have PS, PT1, PX1, PT0, PX0. You know that X means it is something to consider with external hardware. So PX1 and PX0 is for external hardware interrupts. PT1 and PT0 is for timer interrupts. PS is for serial interrupts. Right? So this is what has been decided by the IP register. These are the bits. Okay, now if I want INT1 should be of higher priority, if my requirement is INT1 should be given the higher priority, then what will I do? I will make PT1 as the higher priority. Then how will I make PT1 as the higher priority? Set bit PT1. Once you set the, students. So INT1 should be of higher priority. How will I do this? So I am going to set the bit PX1. Okay, I will set bit PX1. Once I set bit PX1, then INT1, that is the external hardware connected to the pin number 3.3, will be given the higher priority, not the INT0. Okay, so this is one example, that's what I said. Similarly, you can set the priority to any of the interrupts. If my serial communication should be of the highest priority, then set bit PS. Then he will have the highest priority compared to the interrupts that are being generated by the other devices. Whatever the other devices generate the interrupt, that will not be considered as the highest, whereas the interrupt that has been generated by serial communication will be considered as the highest priority. Right? I hope this concept is clear to you. Right? Now, so coming to the external interrupts in 8051. So I said we have two external interrupts, right? And they are INT0 and INT1 connected to port 3.2 and port 3.3, pin number 12 and 13 of 8051. Now, these interrupts could be either level triggered or edge triggered. Okay, so what is level triggered or edge triggered? The interrupts can occur when it is reaches high level or low level. Edge triggering is interrupt can occur either on the rising edge or on the falling edge. Okay. Now, this 8051, okay, is, yeah. So, in 8051 we have, either we can use it as either level triggering or edge triggering. So here is the diagram of a D flip flop. Okay, you can see how this works. This is only for better understanding, students. Okay, please refer your digital electronic circuits and understand how the level triggering and edge triggering works. In edge triggering, what happens is during rising edge of the clock, whatever the input you have, the same thing will be getting at the output. In the level triggering, what happens is when the clock is high, whatever the input you have, the same thing will be getting with the output. Right? That's the difference. That is the basic difference, I can say. Okay. Now, so in 8051, this is low level triggered and falling edge triggered. I said the level triggering could be high level triggering or low level triggering. Edge triggering could be either rising edge triggering or falling edge triggering. Our 8051 goes for, that is, a manufacturer has designed 8051 in such a way that you can have low level triggered or falling its triggered interrupt. Now we have an option. We can make 8051 to be either low level triggered or falling its triggered. Okay, now when we are having an option, we have to tell 8051 how are we going to use the 8051 as? Are we going to use the 8051 as low level triggered or falling edge triggered? Right? Now, this is very much required. Why is this required is the question. unless we tell 8051 how are we going to 8051. Okay, so let us assume that we have made the hardware to be, have designed the hardware in such a way that the hardware generates an interrupt or generates a signal of low level whenever there is a change in the situation. Okay, now in the previous class we discussed, we are going to have a light sensor. Okay, the light sensor is going to generate a low signal whenever the light goes below a threshold value. Clear? Now the sensor has generated low level signal, but when sensor generates a low level signal, what is the responsibility of the 8051? He has to recognize that. Okay, he has to function the interrupt service routine that has been written for that particular interrupt. Now there is a coordination that is required between hardware interface and the microcontroller. Now if the interfacing device is giving a low level triggered input, the 8051 should be able to recognize it. Okay, only if he recognizes, he is going to execute the ISR. To make 8051 to recognize it, we have to tell 8051, see boss, this is the input that you are going to receive from the external hardware that is being connected. How are you going to tell him that? That will be told by our timer and counter register. Okay, similarly, on the other hand, if the sensor, light sensor that you are connecting is giving a falling edge signal, okay, on the interrupt pin of the 8051, even that has to be communicated to 8051. We have to tell what is the output that the interfacing devices are going to generate. Only if you tell 8051, then the 8051 will take it and respond appropriately. If you do not convey that information to 8051, 8051 will not be able to respond and he will not be able to execute the program that has been written in the ISR. You understand, students? That's why I have been telling hardware and software go hand in hand. Okay, once my hardware is giving this sort of signal, I have to tell the 8051 and that could be told by the timer and counter register. In the timer and counter register, the upper 4 bits are used for timer operation, whereas the lower 4 bits, timer and counter operation rather, the lower 4 bits are used for the interrupt related operations. Right, here we have IE1, IT1, IE0 and IT0. Don't worry about IT1 and IT0 at this point of time. The take on register is a special function register in 8051. This has 8 bits like any other register. The upper 4 bits are used for timer related operations, whereas the lower 4 bits are used for interrupt related operations. Right, in the we have IE1 and IE0. These IE1 and IE0 are meant for external interrupt 1 edge flag, and these IE1 and IE0 will be set by the hardware whenever an interrupt occurs on the particular pin. Students, you are already aware we have dedicated two pins, that is port 3.2 and port 3.3 for the interrupt. Okay, and to these pins the external hardware devices will be connected. Okay, so whenever an event occurs, the IE1 and IE0 bit will be set. Okay, and we have IT1 and IT0 bits, right? And these IT1 and IT0 bits have to be either set or reset by the programmer depending upon which type of signal is he expecting on the interrupt pins of the 8051. Right, so as a design engineer, I should be aware whether I am using falling edge triggering or low level triggering. If at all I am using falling edge triggering, then I have to set this IT1 bit if it is pertaining to the interrupt enable or interrupt 1. On the other hand, if at all I am using low level triggering, then I have to reset this bit to to intimate 8051 that I am going to use the low level triggering. It is similarly so for the 80 bit as well, right? So this is how these 4 bits are being used, right? So I have been telling you all these days, the hardware and software goes hand in hand. Okay, when I design the hardware, I should be aware which are the devices that I'm connecting and what is the type of the signal that the devices that are being interfaced are going to generate, right? And whether they are going to generate active high or active low signal. As you are aware, 8051 will be able to understand only if there is a low signal on the pin number 3.3, 3.2 and 3.3. So by chance, if your hardware devices is generating active high signal, you have to put an inverter to revert that and to say that whenever an event occurs, the signal is going to become low instead of becoming high. Okay, these small changes you need to do as a design engineer, because that is the requirement of 8051 students. Okay, see, what is the requirement of 8051? You change your hardware so that it will fulfill the requirement of 8051. You understand? We cannot change the 8051 architecture, right? It is already available in the market. It is designed a few decades ago. It has been manufactured in such a way that, okay, INT1 and INT0 are active low pins. But what we can do as a design engineer is, we can change our design in such a way that our device will be able to communicate properly with the 8051. That is the best thing that we can do, right? And similarly with IT1 and IT0 bits as well. Okay, as a design engineer, you decide whether your interrupt should be either falling edge or low level. Okay, once you decide on that, you set the IT1 and IT0 bits appropriately. You understand? This is what you are expected to do, right? Okay, so the next topic is 8051 assembly language programming to generate an external interrupt using the switch. Okay, here the requirement is, whenever a switch is pressed, right, an interrupt will be generated, right? And here we have designed the circuit in such a way that whenever an interrupt occurs, the port 1.0 has to toggle. Okay, that is the requirement. Now, so here the switch has been connected to port 3.2. You know that it is an interrupt pin. Okay, and you also know that it is an active low pin, right? So here what happens, whenever you press the switch, students, okay, so normally port 3.2 will be high because you have connected port 3.2 to VCC. Okay, normally this pin will be high. As soon as you press the switch, what will happen? This port 3.2 pin will be connected to ground. Once it gets connected to ground, what will happen? 3.2, which was high till now, will go low. You understand? And here there is one more design aspect that you need to understand that one. Okay. See, port 3.2 would have been directly connected to VCC. But what have we done here? We have connected port 3.2 through a pull-up resistor. The very question that you can ask me is, why do you need to have a resistor here? Why can't you connect the port 3.2 directly to VCC? The answer for this is simple. See here, normally port 3.2 will be high. So we do not need to worry about the status of port 3.2 when there is no switch that is being pressed. On the other hand, when you press the switch, if this port 3.2 is directly connected to VCC, what will happen? The ground would be directly shorted to VCC. When a ground gets connected directly to VCC, what will happen? Enormous amount of current will flow through port 3.2. So that will result in damaging of port 3.2 forever. Okay, if you are fortunate, only port 3.2 will be damaged. Sometimes it may damage the other internal circuitry as well. Right? So as a design engineer, I do not want this to happen. So what we do is, whenever we are connecting a circuit, whenever we are connecting a pin between ground and VCC, we normally make sure that we will have a resistor either as a pull-up resistor that is connected to VCC or a pull-down resistor in which we will be connecting a resistor to ground. Okay, the main intention is to see that at any point of time VCC will not be connected to ground. That is the criteria we need to look into, right? Okay, so this is the very reason for connecting the resistor. And we have connected a capacitor across the switch. Normally, whenever we press the switch, what happens is the signal at port 3.2 will not go low immediately. Okay, it will pulse between high and low for some time, and only after certain duration of time it will go low. Right? This is what is called debouncing effect. So by having a capacitor here, the debouncing effect will be reduced, and the pin will be, you will be getting the active low signal within short span of time. Right? That is the very reason for us to put a capacitor across the reset switch. Okay, this is about the hardware designing part. Okay, so this is for you to have a better understanding or more understanding about the designing aspects of the circuitry. Right? Now, let us see how we can write the program to generate a pulse on port 1.0 whenever the INT0 pin goes low. Okay, the algorithm for this is, the very first thing that you have to make is you have to enable all the interrupts, right? If you do not enable the interrupts, even if you have an interrupt on port 3.1, whichever the pin of 8051, the 8051 is not going to recognize that, is it not? So what we do is we enable the all interrupt, that is the global interrupt EA, right? And then we have understood that we are going to connect this to port 3.2, right? When we are connecting this pin to port 3.2, what is the appropriate bit here? Okay, that is IE0 and IT0 are the corresponding bits, right? We also need to tell 8051 how are we going to use this IT0 as, whether we want to do use it as falling gate triggering or low level triggering, right? So what will you do here? We are going to enable the interrupt trigger mode. Okay, so you are making IT0 is equal to 1 to tell we are going to use it as an active low signal. Right? After doing this preliminary setting, then we are going to wait for IE0 to go high. When will the IE0 go high, students? IE0 will go high only when there is an event that happens at the port 3.2. When does when the event takes place in port 3.2? Only when you press the switch. Please do have a look at the diagram. So when you press the switch here, port 3.2 will go high, go low. Right? So when the port 3.2 pin goes low, that then 8051 will understand an event has occurred. When this happens, 8051 will automatically set IE0 bit. You understood, no? So this is how the hardware is related to software. Right? Once IE0 bit is set, we as a programmer understand that an event has occurred. Right? To know this, we have to keep on checking the status of IE0 bit. As soon as IE0 bit goes high, it is understood that an event has occurred. So immediately, what is the requirement that is has to be fulfilled? We have to complement the port 1.0 bit. We understood, no? This is the algorithm. Now, for this algorithm, we have to write the program. And here, we have to write the program using assembly language. Right? So, we start the program at the origin 0000H, and I had told you while we were discussing about the interrupts, right? So normally we write the subroutines in a different location. We do not write the subroutines in the ISR address identified as the for the particular ISR. Okay, I had also told you the very reason for that is, see, if at all I am having an program of 3 to 3 bytes max, I will be able to write the program in this 0003H. Okay, as you can see in the table, students, see, for IE0, the interrupt vector address is 0003. The next interrupt vector address is 000B. What is the gap I have between these two locations is only 8 bytes. If my program fits within these 8 bits, I will be able to fulfill the requirement. But incidentally, what will happen is many a times, the subroutine, whatever I am writing, will not be of only 8 bits. It may exceed 8 bits as well. Okay. So, normally, as a programmer, what we do is, we do not want to take a risk. Okay. So, we normally in the address 0003, we will call a separate subroutine. In that subroutine, the program would have been written. Okay, so lcall subroutine will take 3 bytes max. So that will be able to fulfill the requirement. I mean, that will be able to fit into the memory that has been allocated between these two interrupt service vectors. Okay, so there will not be any problem for the programmer. Right, so by having this as basic information, what we do is, so in the address 0000 have set L jump main. So in the main, we have gone to the main program. Here, what are we trying to do? We are going to enable the interrupt. So we have done set BTA. That is what algorithm has told us, right? So we have set the bit. Then we wanted to make IT0 high. How will you make IT0 high? So we have an instruction for that, right? So we have made set bit IT0. Then what are you supposed to do? You are supposed to wait for IE0 to go high, is it not? So I use the instruction jump on no bit IE0 comma L1. Means as long as IE0 is low, it will be looping in the same place. Right? Once IE0 goes high, you will be going back to the main program. You will go to the main. Means it will go to the beginning of the program. Okay, now once IE0 goes high, what are you supposed to do? You are supposed to complement port 1.0. Now, where are you going to write the program? That program has to be written in the interrupt service routine. The question is, why do you need to write the program there? That is because as soon as IE0 is set, 8051 understands an interrupt has come. So, as soon as the interrupt comes, what will he do? He will immediately jump to the interrupt service routine pertaining to that particular address. Right, what is the address meant for this IE0? You can see in the table. The address meant for this IE0 is 0003H. So, as soon as he finds IE0 becoming high, he will go to the address 0003. Now, in this 0003, what have you told? You have asked it to go to the ISR1. You are calling the subroutine ISR1. Here, what are you doing? You are going to complement the port and you are going to say return on interrupt. So it comes back to this main program. From here it will go to return, means it will go back to the main program. Clear, students? This is how the program works, right? So please do understand, when we speak about embedded systems, when we speak about microcontrollers, there is no, we cannot categorize between hardware and software. Okay, now the knowledge of hardware is very much essential to write the program. Okay, you need to know how the bits will work so that you will be able to design the hardware. Right? So both are complementary. You need to have a good knowledge of both hardware as well as software. Right? Okay. So the next topic is generating a square wave on a port pin using a timer interrupt. Okay, we have been dealing with two interrupts. One is the hardware interrupt, other one is the timer interrupt. We have learned how to write the program using hardware interrupt by using assembly language programming. Now we need to learn how to write a program to generate a square wave using the timer interrupt. Right? So here is the problem. You are expected to write a C program to generate a square wave of 200 microseconds, and the square wave is expected to be generated on port 2.5. And here it has been told you have to use the timer 0 interrupt. Clear? So you have understood what type of waveform you have to generate. You have to generate square waveform. What is the duration? 200 microseconds. And which pin you have to generate? 2.5. Which timer you have to use? Timer 0. Right? All these prerequisites has been clearly told. Now, what is the crystal frequency you want to choose? Let us choose the crystal frequency of 11.0592 MHz. Okay, and in the question it has been told you have to use timer 0, right? Let us use timer 0 maybe. And now when I say that we have to use timer 0, we have two options. We can use mode 1 or mode 2. Normally we do not use mode 0, right? We can go for either mode 1 or mode 2, right? I prefer to go for mode 2 because the duration is only 200 microseconds. If the duration was of the order of milliseconds, I would have used mode 1 because it's a 16-bit timer. Okay, so I prefer to use mode 2 as the duration is only 200 microseconds. and we have to generate a square wave. So this timer has expected to be on for 100 microseconds and off for 100 microseconds, right? Now, so I would prefer to use this timer for a duration of 100 microseconds, students. Okay, as I said, it is a square wave. It is 50% duty cycle. Duty cycle is T on by T on plus T off. So we will have on period 100 and half period of 100 microseconds, right? Now, the next thing that we need to do is we have to find a count. How will you find the count? You know what is the duration you are looking for. You are looking for a duration of 100 microseconds. And you know that you are working with a clock frequency of 11.0592 megahertz. So the internal machine cycle is 1 by 12. Okay. That is 11.0592 divided by 12. Okay, you will get 921.5 kilohertz. Okay, reciprocal of that will be the machine cycle. Now, what will happen? 100 divided by 1.085 microseconds will give you a count of 92. Right? And we know that in 8051, the timers will work as up counter. Okay, whatever the value you are going to load it with, it will start from that value and it will go up to the maximum value. Right? Here, I am going to use the timer in 8 bits. So, what is the maximum number you can think of? 255. Right, so I'm going to use this as an up counter. So I'm going to subtract this 92 from 256. What is the value I'm going to get? 164. So I will be loading the timer with 164. So it will start from 164 and it will go up to 256. Clear, students? Okay. So this is the preliminary work that we have to do before actually writing the program and algorithm and the program. Okay. So now coming to the program. So I will say initialize, I will include res51.h, this is a header file. So I will say LED is equal to port 2.5. Okay. So whenever the interrupt is generated, the LED will become complement of LED. If it is 0, it will become 1 and vice versa. Now, in the main program, what has been written? We have to load TMOD. Okay. We said we are going to use timer 0 in mode 2. So, what is the value you want to load the TMOD register with 0802? Right? And you said what is the value you want to load the TH0 with? You have already done the calculation. Right? So, we will be using TH0 with EF4. And you have to make enable or global interrupt should be high. So, EA will be made high. ET0 will be made high because we are using timer 0 interrupt. And you are starting the timer by saying TR0 is equal to 1. Okay, how long will it take place? This is forever because no other program we have been doing other than generating a square wave. Right, so timer has been started. Now, as soon as the interrupt gets generated, it will go here. That happens once in 100 microseconds. He will complement the port 2.5. He will come back to the main program. He will again start running the timer. And this process continues forever. And you will be able to generate a beautiful square wave with a total time duration of 200 microseconds with 50% duty cycle. Right? Clear? This completes the first part of the last module. Right? I think you are clear with the interrupts, interrupt registers, and how to use the interrupt registers. And how to use the interrupt priority registers as well, depending upon your requirement. Right? Thank you.